All right, so I think we're going to start this panel. The bad news is we're running late, but the good news is they saved the best for last. So this panel will be the best panel of the conference. I'm confident of it. The title of this panel is called Investments Beyond Oil. And on this panel, we have a wide range of people and institutions that represent, I think, a very interesting cross-section of investors and lenders in Azerbaijan. What I'd like to do very quickly is just run through the people on the panel, give a little bit of background, and then I'm going to invite them to talk a little bit about their own products and their own experience in Azerbaijan, Tahir, with you in particular, about how you came to do what you're doing in Azerbaijan and what are the resources that you found the most important. To my left, there's Mr. Mammadov from Sofaz. From 2008 to 2013, he was the chief investment officer of Sofaz. And in July 2013, he was appointed deputy CEO of Sofaz. Quickly, I think you all know who Sofaz is. I'll just read their mission statement. Sofaz's mission is to transform depletable hydrocarbon reserves into financial assets, generating perpetual income for current and future generations. I'll stop there in the mission statement. To his left is Michele Small, director, head of EBRD's North American Representative Office. The primary purpose of the office is to support business development by maintaining and establishing senior relationships with key partners, government officials, and potential foreign direct investors of the EBRD. To her left is Tahir Gozal. Tahir has a very interesting background. He started his career at the Sun Tea Company in Dubai in 1995 as general coordinator and worked in this position until 2000. Most recently, Gozal founded the modern greenhouse company, Green Tech near Baku. And Mr. Gozal is now COO of Green Tech's greenhouse group. And then to his left is Kenneth Angell of the Overseas Private Investment Corporation. Kenneth has 35 years of international financial experience, including 25 years with OPIC, with expertise in project financing, corporate financing, commercial and development banking. And OPIC is the US government's development finance institution. Maybe we could start with Michele.
Oh. I was relaxing then, you know.
And to give some context to it, we've heard a lot of things at this conference today. Maybe you could talk about EBRD's products and process, but more particularly in terms of the non-oil economy. And we've heard a lot of things, including the fact that in 2016, the real economy sank, went down in Azerbaijan by 3.8%. The fact that in Azerbaijan, apparently 55% of the land is agricultural and is in need of certain financial products that would cater to that. And that Azerbaijan presents its unique challenges, and including the recent devaluation, how the EBRD is thinking of addressing that.
Okay.
Thank you.
Well, firstly, the EBRD, we have been investing in Azerbaijan, as in all of our countries, for 25 years. So we have a wealth of experience in these countries. Looking at our portfolio now, it's about 40% infrastructure, 40% energy, and 9% of corporate and financial institutions. Why that's important is that following the fall in the oil prices, we have looked at the economy and decided that it is time to support the non-oil parts of the economy. We're doing that, I think, we're focusing in two ways. So firstly, we're looking at growing SMEs and MSEs by working and engaging with our leading corps that are existing clients, trying to work with other corps that are interested in being transparent with good governance. And we do this either with direct financing or using our partner banks, where we have several line of credits or risk sharing products with them. The second important thing is the banking sector. So we have a strong priority in supporting the financial institutions. We support consolidation. We are looking at investing equity with the partner banks and others that they want to merge with. The other thing that Richard mentioned was the devaluation. So having local currency lending and supporting local currency mismatches that are in the banks is also a priority to us. That's a big mouthful of everything, but I think that the general feeling is that to grow the economy, we have to look at the small and medium-sized companies. We have to look at the non-oil and corporate sectors. Agribusiness is top on our list. We have signed an agreement with the Ministry of Agriculture to support that sector. ICT, as Jennifer, the previous panelist, was talking about, and manufacturing and services. So these are key, and to support them, we support the banks. In terms of products, we work across the range of the capital structure. So we can be an equity partner, we can support via subordinated loans, and then we also have our traditional senior debt. And finally, being a development bank, we work closely with the government to make the country more investable. So a large part of what we do involves policy dialogue and making the country investable. Mm-hmm. And I'll stop there.
Thank you.
Would you like to speak from SOFAS's perspective? SOFAS, I'll give you some background. In 2016, the Azerbaijan GDP was $58 billion. I believe that SOFAS's assets under management were close to $40 billion. $33 billion. So SOFAS is in a bit of a different position. I think they're there for stability and shock absorption. Maybe you can talk about
that. Thank you, Richard. First of all, let me celebrate, congratulate everyone here with the 25th anniversary of our diplomatic relationship between the U.S. and Azerbaijan. What I'd like to say is that earlier today we've talked about in international trade, obviously, as we know, it's a two-way traffic. And we talked about the traffic from the U.S., and I think the ambassador mentioned that U.S. invested about in excess of $12 billion in Azerbaijan. But the traffic from Azerbaijan is unfortunately not very well known, and to some extent it's probably, I would say, invisible part of, it, of this trade. And I would like to share with you some of the numbers, probably just to, as a sort of manifestation of this close ties between Azerbaijan and the United States. So far, Azerbaijan has invested approximately $6.5 billion in the United States economy. And it's in a variety of asset classes, including equities, including the fixed income debt obligations. In addition to that, $16.5 billion invested in the United States USD denominated financial securities, which is quite a substantial, we talk about quite substantial numbers here. Mm-hmm. And I'm not mentioning here the close relationship we have with the Wall Street, all the major financial institutions, and some of them are present here. We cooperate and trade with practically all Wall Street institutions. And I don't want to obviously talk about the volumes of trade we do on a daily or yearly basis, in excess of several billion. Some of the US-based companies provide services, including we had the Bank of New York Mellon earlier today. They are our global custodian. Some of them manage our public equity portfolio. So there are quite a variety of ways we interact with the US-based companies. But coming back to basically SOFAS, what I would like to say is that any discussion we've had earlier today about diversification, about energy projects, would be incomplete without this vital element of the U.S. Of Azerbaijan economy, and it's obviously the state-owned fund of Azerbaijan. We have Azerbaijan has accumulated since the beginning of the production at ACG Azerichirak Güneşli project. Azerbaijan has received in excess of $130 billion, and 33 has been saved. And it's not the end of the story, by the way. We expect to receive another $150 billion of fresh money to the fund. And obviously, even now, we are managing a substantial pool of assets. It is equal to the GDP of the country. So for any investors who is present here, what I would like to say, it's obviously gives quite a good comfort, I would say, when you know that the country you operate in has this cushion and gives a flexibility for the regulators, for the government, and to operate. And my colleagues earlier today, obviously, they mentioned about various structural reforms. And we obviously actively engaged in these discussions. And so fund was set up in 99. We looked into different models, and we've set up our own model with a very sound governance setup. We've learned from different experiences. And two main objectives, as you correctly said. One is to serve as some sort of a shock absorber for the budget, government budget, and the second is as an intergenerational fund, as a fund of future generations. It's obviously quite difficult, some may say, conflicting two objectives, but we obviously try to be innovative in addressing those two main objectives. And what I would like to say is the first objective is being served, fulfilled by sheer fact of our existence. Bylaws of SOFAS do not allow us to invest domestically.
Right.
Maybe people ask why, and obviously these are quite straightforward answer. We as a fund sterilize all those quite substantial, I would say, oil revenues from the economy. And by doing that, we prevent the economy from overheating. Mm-hmm. And all those funds are invested offshore. And when needed, the government obviously withdraws the funds back to Azerbaijan, and we inject it into the budget.
Into the budget.
And this is first object. And obviously, second is that, as you know, many oil-producing countries in the world, if you look around, they have this volatility of their revenues. So what happens in our case is that, obviously, oil is traded in U.S. dollars. We receive those to our fund. And then the budget, it receives, it's isolated from FX volatility and the oil price volatility. That's first. And the second, obviously, intergenerational fund. And what we're trying to do in that respect, since 2011, we've been actively diversifying our investment strategy, moving from pure fixed income cash investor to, at the moment, 15% of our investment portfolio invested in public equities, mm-hmm. private equities, 10% invested in real estate, commercial real estate. And I would say when I say commercial real estate, it's really, really global portfolio. It stretches from commercial property in Ginza, in Tokyo, Seoul, London, Milan, and other cities. And also 5% in our portfolio we've invested in gold. The remaining is in fixed income. But it's not the end. We have submitted our proposals to the supervisory board and to the government to increase allocation for public equities. And the objective is obviously to maximize risk-adjusted return, long-term risk-adjusted return. Obviously, that can be achieved only by, as you know, by moving into more risky asset classes. And I'm obviously happy to answer the questions. What a couple more things. We, as a fund, Also, not people, many people know that primarily almost in excess of 95%, 90% of all assets are managed internally by the fund itself. So we are structured as any other asset manager, with all the operations, trading floors, settlements. And the final thing what I would like to say is that we are very proud of our achievements in accountability and transparency. This is fundamental principles of our operations. And just a couple of numbers. In 2007, we received United Nations Public Award for being the most transparent government-owned institution in the Eastern European area. And recently, Peterson Institute for International Economics, Washington-based, I think, think tank, they have ranking of 60 sovereign wealth funds in terms of transparency and accountability, and we are ranked as the sixth most transparent and accountable sovereign wealth fund. So that's basically, in a nutshell, where we are.
Thank you. We'll come back to maybe some questions later about that. Tahir, do you want to share your experience in Azerbaijan?
Thank you very much. I'll
especially in light of what was just described to us, which is a stabilizing influence by Sovaz. I listen to what you say, and I wonder, should we be concerned about the fact that the currency was allowed to float? It seems that one of the benefits of SOFOS is that it can make repatriation back to the budget, especially in times where there's devaluation going on or there's a run on, you know, hard currency reserves. And that's a really great thing. Tahir.
Thank you. In the previous panel, there was a wonderful question. In a country with 9 million residents, what do you do that could be exciting? And but you have to listen to me for some minutes. I've flown 18 hours. You better listen to me for 10 minutes. Now, the whole thing starts in 1992. The Azerbaijan is broken from the Soviets. The 65% almost of GDP is decimated. None of the factories which were networked in the Soviet Empire worked. And at that time, my family, we were the largest wholesalers in the region. We had businesses in Sri Lanka. We knew the tea business. And we had business with Unilever. So we're Unilever's distributors in the region, in Syria, what was then Iraq, and Romania, and also Azerbaijan. So at that time, the great leadership of, you know, a credible person, historic character, Heydar Aliyev, just made a small room and brought all the businessmen at that time. There were American Iranians, there were Turkish businessmen, there were us. And he said, I need investments in this country. And what can be done? So Azerbaijan used to be a very well-known tea producer in Soviet system. So we said, sir, if you allow us, if you support us, we think that an investment in tea business is a good idea. Your tea situation is very bad, and you know the situation in the gardens, it needs rehabilitation. And we started working on that. By the way, let me just come to the current terms. Today, that $1 million initial investment now is a giant manufacturing base. Azerchai is now the single most important brand of Azerbaijan in the world. It's sold in 25 countries now. And it's the third and best recognized tea brand in Russia, which is 160 million population. So we went on, and then we saw there's this giant infrastructure of vegetable oil processing. Everything in it is stolen. There's nothing in there. But the building is gorgeous. It's just this Soviet massive structure. And Heydar Aliyev is pushing all of us. He's, you know, he had this great motivational speeches. And I really think he hypnotized my father, the chairman of our. He just knew how to talk to us, to all the businessmen. So we returned to Unilever. We said, listen, guys, would you invest with us in Azerbaijan? They go, you know what, to make a country profile of Azerbaijan would take us 3 years. It has to go to there, to Holland. You guys go in there, we will support you. We said, but in one condition, will you allow us to produce your brands in our factory? Which is the way to say, very smart way of saying, will you give your technologies to us? Because they would never allow anybody to produce their product without the know-how. And we said, and let us sell these products from here to our bases. And we promise we'll make our efforts double. They agreed with Unilever's blessing. We did that phenomenal work in the vegetable oil business. Later on, as we travel with my father, we're in Germany, and there is this guy we meet somehow, and you know, the people introduce us in the Chamber of Commerce, and it says, "Hello, my name is Dieter. I sell sugar refinery. It's no good here anymore. Would you like to buy in Azerbaijan? It will work." So as we come back, again, we're meeting. Again, it's the businessman, and Haider Aliyev is there making a speech. It's not enough. We need to do more. We need sugar for us is a strategic asset. It's a strategic food supply. We need a sugar factory. Who could do it? And my father has a thing for the Germans. I mean, really, he loves them. A German to him never lies. A German delivers. So he raises his hand, says, "Sir, can we do it? We would love to do it." And he says, "But should be in Baku. It should be in Imishli. It's the middle of nowhere. Birds don't fly there, you know." And we go like, I say, "Father, shall we do some analysis, environment impact analysis, market?" He says, "Tahir, remember what Dieter said? He said it's going to work." I said, "He said he's German." I said, "All right then." So we made our investment in the Michele sugar plant. And really, the strategic idea of sugar was interesting to us because a sugar is a cluster of investments. Once you have a sugar refinery, you have molasses, you have meal, you have alcohol production. So we liked that idea. So after sugar, then came the United Nations, the UNICEF made a report that in Azerbaijan, because of lack of iodine, there is a thyroid problem, which is epidemic in the country. The children are born with problems, and this had to be immediately resolved. It was a matter of urgency. And the only group in the country that had the know-how of crystallization, that had the network already by that time, you know, we're selling all these products. We have 14,000 points of delivery. And we thought, you know what? And all these people are coming, giving us business cards. There's one beautiful company from Switzerland comes and says, "You know what? We do only one thing. We do salt refining." And there was this wonderful salt lake in Azerbaijan. So we bought a piece of land, and there we are, we're doing the salt factory. And after it was done, I will never forget, my father looked at it and said, "Son, I'm proud of what we've done. If we don't do a strategic mistake, we won't end up in hell. We did something really good." And I go like, "Dad, I'm a philosopher. I believe hell is in the mind. It rises and ends in the mind." To which his wise answer was, "Shut up." So we moved on, and then we have this, the governors, regional governors, they come to us, they say, "Listen, we have a problem. In Azerbaijan, we have these seasons of outburst of these fruits and vegetables for a very short time, high quantity. The market prices get collapsed. And would you buy some of these products? And we'll say, but what would we do with it? Would you sell to Russia?" "Well, it doesn't work because these people already have connections to Russia. We wouldn't do any add-on." So we had a bit of brainstorming. Again, the entrepreneurial family, a lot of energy in the family. And we said, "Why don't we do canning investing, to can them?" So we buy from them when it's cheap. We add extra demand to the economy. We'll save it in the cans and we'll sell it in winter. And we do it in glass packaging, so our environmental impact on Earth is minimal, because glass, you can recycle them as much as you want. So there went our, we started to do four canning investments in the country. Then the next step was greenhouses. We started to like open agricultural fields before I started about greenhouses. The government came to us and they said, "Tahir, you know, Gozal family, would you like to do big scale agriculture?" We said, "But there is no land in Azerbaijan. It's small, tiny. And to make a proper profitable investment in agriculture, you need scale." They said, "But we do have a piece of land. It's absolutely amazing. 3,800 square, hectares of land. In Azerbaijan, one piece? I wonder why nobody worked there." Well, nobody did because it was salty. A lot of sodium, a lot of boron, nothing would grow there. And we're stuck, and we're talking to our friends in the U.S. Embassy, and we meet and we exchange business cards. Just a meeting like this, somebody says, "Hello, we're from Valmont Industries." "Valmont, what do you do?" He says, "Well, we wherever there's problem with water, with salinity, with the, you know, if you have problems with that, that's what we resolve." And that's where we started a cooperation with them. And they did a phenomenal work. So what we did on this lands, which has filled with salt, Basically, we just dripped sweet water. And just for 2-3 years, that's all we did. The sweet water pushed the salty water down. Suddenly, you won't believe, just the holy cold, the birds start to come in. And the, you know, the droplets started to, you know, make the natural fertilizers that the plant need. And then you have worms, and then you have a whole new ecology in the region. And today, it's one of the most productive fields in Azerbaijan. We're working on it now. And then we went and we thought, okay, we are next to Russia, and our greatest asset that we have, the Russians don't have, is the amount of sun. As I mentioned in my previous talk here, it's a very strange border. Anything beyond Azerbaijan, you cannot raise vegetables naturally. Either you need additional lighting with high-tech sodium lamps, which is called assimilation, which means double your investment, or your products are weak. So we started to invest in greenhouses. We started small, and now it's 330,000 square meter. That's 55 football stadiums, if you put next to each other. Then obviously we had an enormous requirement for corrugated boxes. We started to invest in corrugated box factory. Then paper recycling made sense. Plastic recycling made sense. We invested in all these factories. And one day somebody says, Tahir, there's a petroleum week in London. Would you like to attend? I thought, well, why not? You know, let's have a go at that. And then I meet somebody from Chevron there. And I say, hello, I'm from Azerbaijan. He goes, I don't like you. I go like, whoops. Yeah. He says, so what is the problem? He says, well, we carry this product through Azerbaijan. There is this strange Turkish businessman, and the losses are terrible, and he doesn't perform his contracts. And we would love Azerbaijan as an alternative corridor to Russia, but we just can't come in. And he owes us money. So I said, sir, can I have your business card? I went, talked to the businessman. I came back to Chevron. I said, listen, if I take over his debt, and I promise I'll be one of the best suppliers, transportation companies to you, would you work with me? It took us 3 years to sign the contract. It was 180 pages. We learned a lot. We did sign the contract. Proud to say we shifted 150 million barrels of TCO crude through Azerbaijan. And this is non-oil investment because it's got nothing to do with Azerbaijani oil. And now, where are we now in today's world? Now, this was what happened till now. Today, I think the Azerbaijan's manat and USD exchange rate gives us, it opens a new era for us, really. We're quite excited on what can be done. And one of the things that we want to do now is actually to source more of our products internally. So we're aiming now to invest in sugar beet. Mm-hmm. So we talk to farmers to source it locally rather than import from Brazil the raw sugar. And we have 100,000 trees of pomegranate juice. By the way, we have some samples here. I really do encourage you. Nobody beats Egyptian cotton yet. It's not been beaten. It's just natural. It's the gift of nature. Honestly, we have no competition. In the highest quality of pomegranate, Azerbaijan is a God-blessed natural monopoly. Just drink it and you will know what I'm talking about. So we're very excited.
An amazing story. Yeah. It sounds like a serendipitous story.
Thank you very much.
So one of the things that maybe Kenneth can talk about is financial tools that are available for doing many of the things that you've done. And I'll say something, maybe you don't want me to tell the group this, but we had a conversation a little while ago and you said, we self-finance most of our internal costs. In other words, working capital required in an agricultural business with a long product cycle, they're self-financing that. That's a tax. That's an implicit tax on any business. So one of the advantages of EBRD and OPIC is that they can provide a range of products that address all that. And I know that in the case of EBRD, often there's technical assistance funds. The story you related about finding people is essentially things that are made available, that can be made available by the IFIs through technical mm-hmm. assistance, which is a very important piece of the pie. Kenneth.
Thank you. As you may have heard in the introduction, the Overseas Private Investment Corporation is the US government's development finance institution. OPIC facilitates US businesses that want to invest overseas. And we do this through, in Azerbaijan, providing investors with financing and political risk insurance. I'll briefly touch on these and then talk about what it is that we've done in Azerbaijan. So for political risk insurance, what we mean is the threat that political changes could affect the profitability or the viability of an investment. And it's three different categories: inconvertibility, expropriation, and political violence. So inconvertibility addresses the issue of currency conversion and transfer out of the country. For expropriation, it addresses confiscation and nationalization of assets. And for political violence, it addresses the loss to assets and business income due to political violence or terrorism. In the area of finance, OPIC provides long-term, medium to long-term financing, such as direct loans and loan guarantees to eligible investors. We complement the private sector investment in countries where conventional financial institutions are reluctant or unable to lend on such a basis. The key item for OPIC financing is that it requires US involvement. So this is a major difference than my colleague from EBRD. EBRD does not have any preconditions, shall we say. But for OPIC, it requires US involvement in the project company in an amount that's equal to 25% of the project company's equity. This can be satisfied by equity investments. It can be satisfied by long-term debt investments, other US contracts, such as construction, operating, maintenance or service contracts, offtake purchases arrangements, franchises, or a combination of all these things, again, to equal 25% of the equity. Just a few quick data points. As far as the amount, OPIC loans go between $1 million and $250 million. As far as the tenor, we can look at loans that would be 5 to 20 years. And the leverage, we would look at providing up to 50 to 60% of total project costs for a new project and up to 75% of the total project costs for an expansion. In Azerbaijan, we've not been there as long as EBRD has been. We've only been working there for 14 years. And over that period of time, we've provided roughly $250 million in long-term financing and political risk insurance to companies in Azerbaijan. The projects have all been non-oil sector. It's primarily been in the financial services sector. And it is also primarily in the small and medium enterprise, or SME, sectors. Currently, OPIC has about $25 million exposure in about 7 projects in Azerbaijan. We've provided funds for several banks operating in Azerbaijan in order to expand their small and medium enterprise lending portfolios. This would be Rabita Bank, Tehran Bank, and Mugan Bank are 3 that come to mind. OPIC also has loan projects with 2 non-banking credit organizations, CRED Agro and TBC Credit. So sectors in which OPIC is interested in financing would include US franchises, agriculture that was mentioned, so it could either be in cold storage, agro processing, hotels and tourism, healthcare, education. These are all areas that OPIC has been financed in the country next door in Georgia. So there's no reason why there couldn't be opportunities here in Azerbaijan for US investors. So in short, what I wanted to say is that the theme of the conference is to diversify the Azerbaijan economy. And OPIC stands ready to facilitate US investment in Azerbaijan. OPIC is open for business in Azerbaijan, providing political risk insurance, as well as financing and loan guarantees. Thank you.
Thank you, Kenneth. So I'll ask this a couple of questions, and then maybe we take questions from the audience, because they're really here for your benefit, for you to learn about what they do. Someone comes to OPIC with a project. The project can be in any configuration. What I mean is every business is different. You have a working capital need of 180 days, or you have a working capital need of 365 days. Perhaps you want to refinance some local debt that you have. These are all things that OPIC can consider when it looks at a project?
Yes, they are. OPIC, primarily the focus is medium to long-term financing, but we look at everything that goes into a loan, so the total project costs. So it could be where there would be some refinancing of local debt, as Richard mentions. Some of the things that we would not do would be just to finance a straight privatization. It would have to be something more that's there, because we're looking for the developmental. Again, OPIC is the developmental financial institution. So while it's a bank, it also, like the EBRD, there are certain developmental aspects, whether it have to do with environment, whether it have to do with worker rights, but what are the developmental benefits that the project would have. So when it comes for working capital, generally, we would work with a local financial institution to provide that local working capital for short term. If it's for long term needs, that's where it would make sense for it to be part of the OPIC loan.
And let me just add that this morning there was somebody from Ex-Im Bank here. They play a very important role. They don't do what OPIC does. So they do working capital guarantees, they do export finance, which is a very important function. But this is project finance, which is you have a special purpose company or you have a company that you've acquired and are running in the country.
Right. The focus for OPIC is investment.
Correct. Let me turn it over to you. So, with all the assets that you have under management, have you considered or are you working with the IFIs to manage funds with some of those assets so that you can invest them, well, not yourself, but you can maybe invest them through a third party?
Well, yes. In fact, it's a good question. We have, when we started our private equity program, it was quite difficult to explain it to the stakeholders in Azerbaijan, where the financial industry or the investment management industry to some extent is not in its infancy to some extent. And the private equity as an asset class is very new to Azerbaijan. So we've invested approximately $350 million together with IFC into the three funds managed by the IFC Asset Management. One is the Africa, Latin America, and Caribbean Fund. It's an opportunistic sort of fund which invests in a wide range of industries. The reason why we've decided to start this program with IFC, the second one is an infrastructure fund, which is about $1 billion fund. We're a cornerstone investor in this fund. Mm-hmm. We invest about $200 million. And another very important one, we've just talked about the renewables earlier today. We've also invested approximately $50 million into so-called Climate Catalyst Fund, right, which is fund of fund mm-hmm. structure and invest globally in funds in emerging markets in renewable energy.
Not oil.
So sort of diversifying. It helped us, of course, results are to be seen because it's a still relatively new initiative, but it helped us to some extent to start this program, because obviously we wouldn't go to countries, especially frontier markets in Africa or sub-Saharan Africa, where we don't have any expertise or don't have any presence. So partnering with IFC, obviously, to some extent, gave us some additional political sort of comfort. In many of those countries, unfortunately, risks come from some of the governments, unfortunately. So therefore, that's one direction. And also with our EBRD partners, they've pioneered a new platform. It's Equity Participation Fund. And we've recently, together with a Chinese investment company, CIC, we've invested approximately €100 million commitment to that particular fund, which is obviously widens our sort of geography more towards CIS and Eastern European, right, and also obviously new areas in North Africa and other countries. So it was a start of our program, mm-hmm, but now we have moved into more sort of major flagship funds like Blackstone's, you know, Carlyle and others, and quite actively present, and specifically in the U.S. market as well. We've invested in those funds, right, as well.
Thank you. Are there questions from the crowd for anyone up here on the, please?
Sorry.
So we can't hear.
Compare EBRD and OPIC.
I think compare EBRD and OPIC. We do similar things. And I think there's one thing we should mention is that we do cooperate. So it's not a matter of picking one or the other. We operate in a lot of markets. We are more specialized. I think OPEC has a global reach, whereas we are specialized towards Eastern Europe and now the new North African countries. But we do cooperate. We don't have the restriction on having to have a U.S. Ownership in terms. And I think we do more, correct me if I'm wrong, Ken, we do more equity-type instruments than I think the OPIC would do.
Yes, I would add, thank you, Michele. OPIC does, on the financing side, OPIC does debt only. OPIC does not take equity. So that's a significant difference. I think also OPIC has a tendency, OPIC can handle smaller loans than EBRD in general. I guess one other aspect that comes to mind is that within a project, correct me if I'm wrong, Michele, but I think it's about 35% of the total project cost that EBRD would take. So
exactly,
if you want to call it a limitation.
Yeah.
While as OPIC does not have that limitation, it can go up to $250 million, and the limitation only has to do with the overall leverage of the project. So just to make it very clear, if you had a project that required a $100 million project, EBRD could be involved with up to 35%.
Yes, but just one of the reasons that we have that limitation is that we are pushed to mobilize finance. So one of our targets is where we go, we try to take for every dollar, $3 of someone else's money. As my friend over here, Israfil has been saying, it's, you know, we give comfort to the investors when they go to a region. So if we were to say, well, you know, we're going to participate 50%, we don't mobilize that at a, you know, 25%. So that's why we have that limitation, one of the primary reasons for that limitation.
Right.
And hence, we can work together.
Exactly. Yeah.
There's room for others, and we don't want to crowd out commercial investment,
right,
and
so
other IFIs.
I would also add that if you're borrowing in local currency, what EBRD is doing is very significant. Yeah.
And I think this is actually quite important to Azerbaijan, because we're working, which I forgot to mention in my preamble, closely with the central bank to try to issue this year, we're working on the reforms and regulations and the market to look at a local currency bond.
Yeah, I heard about
bond,
this.
Yeah.
That's great.
Which I think is quite important.
Terrific.
Because there will be a squeeze on the corporates who are borrowing in dollars and since the devaluation.
Yeah.
And we're trying to get most of our economies to towards local currency.
Same restrictions or the same requirements
Right. I wouldn't say that it would be a restriction. I would say it's a requirement, and it's prudent banking sense.
Yes, exactly.
You want to have, rather than someone that has a great idea but and has a little bit of money but wants to use most of my money, I don't get very comfortable in doing something like that. I'd rather have someone who has experience working in the industry so they know what are the ups, the downs, and what the risks are there, rather than otherwise, that's a role for venture capital, and that's not up, neither one of us do venture capital.
Yeah. I think what we would say as well is that, you know, sound banking is one of our priorities. We are not an NGO. We are a we act as a commercial bank. But we do have programs, as Richard was saying earlier, we have capacity building programs. So we're working with small business to sort of bring you to the point where you become financeable. So we have programs like that.
Municipalities are collected together and they want to do the waste management. Mm-hmm. And but they are small municipalities, they don't have the, that collateral or that thing that you want. But at the same time, the business is very profitable, you know, you bring that stuff. And is there any way that is any exemption or any kind of relaxation of the rule?
So let me just jump in here. So One big distinction here is corporate finance versus project finance. Everything in life is really a combination of those things, all right? But in project finance, you're looking more at cash flows in the future, lending against those cash flows. You still need collateral and security, as opposed to a corporate finance or maybe something that's being done by commercial banks, where you are lending against a balance sheet that's been audited. And the transparency is so important, which is why what you're doing is so important. Because many people could say that the US system is not transparent. That even with all the regulations that we have here, that you can look at a balance sheet and still not truly understand what a company is doing. So a lot of the assistance that's going on is for small and medium-sized businesses. They can put together financial reports that mean something, and people can understand it when they read it.
And I think, jumping in again, the other sort of important thing that we do when we look at this, we're too big and cumbersome to lend to the very, very small borrowers. However, that's why we work with the banks. So we issue credit lines specifically for certain areas, and let the banks on the ground who know, you know, who can smell the deal better than we can. Let them perform that that very valuable exercise.
Thanks.
Just a question for Phil and Tahir. Could you share a little bit about your preference for a hurdle rate?
Sorry?
Hurdle rate.
Well, when it comes to the hurdle rate, overall as a fund, the main objective is the preservation of the fund, which is in beating the inflation to some extent, obviously. But if we're talking about the variety of asset classes, obviously, then depending on the asset class, depending on the geographies or strategies or etc. We obviously have a different hurdle rates for our investments. So that's where we stand.
For us in Azerbaijan, I would normally say we use 8% on a dollar basis, 8% annual as a baseline. But in my experience, a lot of our investments are very strategic in nature. We take a very, very long view. And we've done that in Azerbaijan. And a lot of our investments still has to pay back. But that has given us a power base. But if you say a number that we normally see is 8%.
I would just add one more distinction. In Georgia, there's a sovereign wealth fund. I won't tell you what it is. This sovereign wealth fund invests, but what they require more than a hurdle rate is a guaranteed exit. So if you go and you do a project with them, what they're really looking for is a put. Is a put against the other shareholders that's liquid and they can actually get out. That's a lot of what drives the investment criteria here.
What was the question there?
Yeah,
I'll try to be loud enough so that I don't need a microphone. I'm Andre from the U.S. Department of Agriculture. I kind of want to tie this thing together. We're looking at investments beyond oil, and we know agricultural production is a risky sector. We also talked about how small and medium-sized enterprises is the way to go as far as expanding the Azerbaijani economy. So with that being considered, are any of these mechanisms available to small farmers who take on these risks that might not fit this criteria? And if these mechanisms are available, are they taking advantage of
it? Right, I think I'll go.
I'll let you go.
We do look at the smaller the farmers, and we try to do it. I'm not sure. We're working with the Ministry of Agriculture in Azerbaijan. I'm not sure whether we're there yet. But in other countries, for instance, we would look at thinking it's the same system as having a credit line. So we would try to find a local partner bank that can then on-lend towards specific criteria. Because in agriculture, we go through the whole value chain from, as they say, farmer to spoon. So because it's an important sector, not just in Azerbaijan, but we see it as an important sector within the bank, we look at innovative ways of reaching the smaller participants.
Yes, in a similar way for OPIC, we have not found that, again, going back to, for OPIC, there has to be the U.S. Involvement. So there's been, mm-hmm. since there's been a lack of that, what we have done is similarly gone through banks. And I mentioned three of them that are lending to SMEs. And so it's up to the bank then to be able to take a look at it. But in general, when we would look at an agricultural project, it's probably one that we would not go as far as primary growing because the risks are very high there. So when I talk of agriculture, it'd be any type of processing, any type of supply chain that is involved, cold storage, logistics, anything that has to do along those lines to be able to do. So particularly what Tahir was talking mm-hmm. about, that would be if you had a U.S. company, U.S. involvement.
Yes, well, as an entrepreneur, I'll tell you, the greatest problem the small farmers have is lack of education. We're also the representative of Monsanto in the region. We represent all the Monsanto seeds in the region. And when we sell the seeds, the scenery that we saw, the lack of education mm. of how to grow, how to, very simple stuff, it really was bewildering. So we started an education program. Every time, if any farmer wants to buy the seed from us, there's only one condition, they have to be trained, they have to come to our centers. We have experimental centers. Mm. So I think education and training of the farmers, it comes before the finance. Mm. Because in Azerbaijan, there's actually quite a good level of mid-level wholesalers that have access to Russian markets. And they're all family members, they're cousins, they buy and sell from each other. And if the guy can increase his production per meter basis, this automatically transfers into cash and he will have his own money to invest further. Mm. They do it with very, very simple constructions. So again, I would say education, and I'm very proud to say, I think we're doing a great job in there. Mm.
I would just add that very few lenders are going to take crop risk. Mm-hmm. It's very hard for a lender to take crop risk. However, if you structure the right transaction where you have enough flexibility to have enough working capital to keep you from cycle to cycle without violating any of your ratio or your covenant tests, that's a very good thing. And there are always commercial programs available where you can do warehouse financing, where you can, you know, you can finance against receivables if you can get them risk rated. Mm-hmm. You know, so it requires a combination of approaches, I think.
And by the way, for the very reliable medium enterprises, we ourselves provide finance. Mm-hmm. So we do that. We give them the seedling. We give them this, and we only receive after 4 or 5 months when they have the money back. Mm-hmm. So we do a bit of that as well.
Okay, I think that's it. Thank you, everybody. Thank you, panel.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.